send it out.
Are you working for the PowerPoint?
Not the PDF.
Have I only got the PowerPoint?
I think this is yours. The only one listed here is the PowerPoint.
Should I put it up as a PDF? I put it on the
PowerPoint. It works. Well,
does it work?
I think so, because this is mine.
Oh.
Here you go. It's yours.
Okay. Okay.
Well, we open the speech.
Yeah, mine's
open.
And there you go. Where's yours? It uploaded. Okay, what they want us to do.
Yeah.
That one? It's not open yet, is it? It's not open. They want me to copy it into a folder.
Oh, okay.
So copy?
Copy.
Or cut.
No, copy.
Copy. And so we are in Timor Leste. Open.
How are you doing, guys?
Good.
Very nice to meet you.
So you're open too? Yeah. Minimize. So Trish is going first, so.
You're waiting for Andrew Mahar, didn't you?
Yeah, I think so. I'm not sure. Joyce has just gone out.
It's on here.
Okay.
We've had a huge technical
problem.
All right. Open.
Now, have we got half an hour, or have we got 20 minutes?
I don't know. I don't think
20 minutes to joke and 10 minutes for questions.
Okay. And the questions I was told are going to be all at the end, not
after.
That's
up to George. I think it was all at the end.
Sorry, it's entirely up to the person.
I think it's a panel at the end.
Okay. All right.
So slideshow. Start from the first slide.
Well, honestly, all I'm here to do is to try and get this nightmare presentation from Andrew Mahar.
Skype's ready to go, is it?
Skype is sitting here.
Have you got it working in small hall?
Sorry?
Is it working in small hall?
Yes.
Oh, okay.
Alan, George, female George outside, is our facilitator.
Okay. George?
Right,
you're gonna have to use this laptop because Andrew's stepped in asking about Andrew's film. It's too big for the
presentation.
So just you
so the
time
is when you're ready, obviously this will just wait, but at least we know.
Somebody gonna have to this. I'm sorry about this. Andrew's not mine. It's here, it's ready to go. You just need to press play.
We have all of us
it's trying to get full screen.
Nobody knows more than that. And she's got a point. I still know
So you're going to have to be in charge of you're going to have to be in charge of the Skype. If you get it on Skype and then get back on the Skype, you can try and run this.
With
everyone. in space, but is it but these arrows? Have a practice now. That did exactly nothing. Try the up arrow.
Left and right?
This one here.
Yeah, left and right. Okay.
Where's Andrew? Is he in Timor?
He's in Melbourne. He has been told that if we can't get him on Skype, so do your best if you get him. I wouldn't use the camera. His film is on there, so it's 15-minute long film. So he's still 15 minutes. Right, I'm going to see if everybody else is doing it. Good luck. Enjoy, Trish.
It's a real honour to actually be able to present what's happening on a different continent. And first, we've got two speakers from East Timor. We've got one joining us from Melbourne for the Q&A, but he's sent us a film, so we're going to look at that in the third session. Second session, I think, in fact. And so we're going to kick off with Trisha Allen from New Zealand. Very beautiful part of the South Island.
North.
So much for Google Maps. And Trish has been working since the 80s on a Rainbow Valley farm, and she's going to tell us about how she transitioned to an urban setting, to a village setting. So I'm going to let Trish kick off.
Okay, thanks, George. Well, good morning, everyone. It's so nice to see some faces that I know here. Robin Francis, who's a very well-known permaculture teacher, who has taught on Rainbow Valley Farm. Thank you for coming along, Robin. So, permaculture from the farm to the village. Today, I want to take you on a journey of two permaculture projects that have been my life's work for the past 27 years. The first one, Rainbow Valley Farm, for 23 years. The project to create an abundant permaculture paradise from degraded land. And the second, village permaculture from 2011 until the present, creating abundance in suburbia. So I hope to give you an understanding of how my late husband Joe Polisha and I applied the principles of permaculture to our land and to our lives,
and hopefully to show you some examples that you might find useful, and even perhaps inspire you on what can be done with degraded land to make it productive and to restore its health. So I was born in New Zealand, and Joe was Austrian. And we discovered permaculture in 1984. And the concept of permaculture captured our imaginations because it brought together under one umbrella all the strands of ecological wisdom that were important to us. So permaculture made sense to us, and we were really keen to put it into action. So we dreamt of living a simple life, treading lightly on the earth, being self-sufficient. We wanted to grow our own food organically without the use of chemicals, and we wanted to restore the land and safeguard the life-supporting systems of air, water, soil, and ecosystems for future generations. So in 1988, we bought 50 acres of degraded, rundown farmland in the north of New Zealand, about 10 kilometres from the sea. We called it Rainbow Valley Farm because of the many rainbows that we saw arching over our secluded valley. This is a warm temperate zone with a high rainfall, about 2,000 millimetres a year, but most of it in winter. And this land had a sad history. The original European settlers came in, cut down all the trees for timber, burnt off the rest to create pasture for sheep and cattle. But this is rainforest land. The soils are very, very fragile. So with the first rains, this little bit of topsoil that there was washed off the steep hillsides, down into the stream, and out into the ocean. So the land, when we bought it, was badly eroded, and it was infested with pests and weeds. So we knew we had a really big job ahead of us. We moved onto the land in a house truck, and we lived there for a couple of years until we built some buildings. This is how we got clean. It was real pioneering stuff. Our first priority, to get a water supply, and fortunately we had springs on our land. So, and then very quickly we needed to get some food gardens established. And then we started on our permaculture design, observation. Identifying what resources we had on the land, observing where the summer sun came up, where it went down, where the winter sun came up, where it went down, where the cold winds came from, where the warm, all of that permaculture design process. And of course, we developed our first permaculture design plan. This was our first garden, and this was our first permaculture design plan for the property. And then we started to implement our plan. The first thing we needed to do was plant a windbreak. We got cold winds from the southwest, and we needed to get shelter up before we could plant anything else. And then, of course, we planted our orchard. We started to mill timber for buildings, build buildings, but most importantly, build soil. That was our biggest task. The problems I mentioned, we had erosion, and we planted many, many thousands of trees to stabilise the land, and to, especially along the stream banks. The kind of weeds that we were dealing with, gorse was introduced to New Zealand from Scotland as a hedging plant, but in New Zealand, with our climate, it exploded. So it just is a big problem all across the whole country. Some of the other weeds we had, possums. Possums were introduced to New Zealand from Australia for the fur industry. But in New Zealand, they have no natural predators. The population has totally exploded, and they're killing our forest, and you can't grow anything in New Zealand unless you take care of the possum problem. So we needed to grapple with these problems and find permaculture solutions. You probably all know the permaculture saying the problem is the solution. So we needed to turn these problems into solutions. And I don't have time to go into them in detail now, but maybe at question time at the end we can talk about it a bit more. Building soil. this was really, really important. Of course, we made thousands of tons of compost, but we also needed to use animals to help us, worms. We used worms, we used pigs. You can see a pig tractor up there, a little enclosure with a small pig inside. Every day we moved the enclosure, the pig ate the grass, it fertilised, it dug up the land and prepared the land for planting our orchard. And you can see where it's been the day before. We also did the same with rabbits, rabbit tractors, and with chickens. Our shelter belt, our wind shelter, you can see it, we planted it in 1988. You can see the small trees surrounded by mulch, and these sticks here are multi-purpose shelter belt, multi-species. And in the next picture, you can see 20 years later, it was a very, very effective wind shelter. This aerial photograph from 1990 shows how that shelter has grown up along the boundary with the neighbour. You can see here our newly planted orchard, each little tree surrounded by mulch, and we've done an excavation to build a house. And then 6 years later, you can see the progression. We have the shelter belt here, the windbreak quite well established, the orchard, and a completed house with an earth roof that just blends into the landscape. A farm, a barn over there. Here we have the boundary with the neighbour in 1988. This is our land on this side and the neighbour's land on that side. You can see our shelter, newly planted shelter trees. And 20 years later, the neighbour's land looks exactly the same, and Rainbow Valley Farm was completely transformed. We have down here a orchard, and our orchard, a food forest, house gardens, chickens, nursery, all the different zones, and then going up the hill, firewood trees, fuel trees, all kinds of timber trees. And the same here, you can see establishing our house garden in front of, immediately in front of our house in 1993, Keyhole Gardens. And in the background, the orchard, you'll see here a rabbit tractor and a pig tractor. And then 20 years later, the same picture. Within a very short space of time, we had built up quite a considerable amount of soil. It went amazingly fast. Nature is wonderful. This is a picture from 2 years after we moved onto the land. You can see it's in winter with the newly planted orchard trees. The same year in spring, and every tree is surrounded by comfrey, which of course we all know has deep tap roots to bring up the nutrients from deep down in the soil. And the same picture 20 years later, it's just a jungle. Some of the crops that grew very well for us, we had more than 50 different species of food, fruit trees and food plants and nuts and all kinds of things. A mixed orchard, tropical, subtropical, temperate zone plants, they all grew very well. One of the things that we experimented with was growing rice, which was not very usual. No one else was doing it in New Zealand. So we dug a small rice paddy, and it took a few years of experimenting, but we eventually got it right, and we harvested about 50 kilos of rice from that small paddy every year. Mushroom growing. We grew shiitake mushrooms on oak logs and oyster mushrooms on cardboard boxes stuffed with banana leaves. Bees, of course, essential to any permaculture farm. And honey was one of our products that we sold. So what did we do with all that food? Well, we did a lot of preserving, drying. We used a solar dehydrator to dry our fruit. And of course, we sold it on our local farmers market. We sold vegetables, fruit, honey, plants, flowers, just eggs, whatever we had, we sold every week on our farmers market store in the village. We had all kinds of birds on the farm, chickens, ducks, guinea fowl, pigeons, turkeys, peacocks, most of them free ranging in our orchard as part of our integrated pest management system, and also to fertilise the land and to get rid of the insect pests. Sheep for wool and for meat. House cows, we had a great supply of our own milk for making yogurt and cheese and butter. And now I'll just show you a few pictures of the house that Joe built. This was our house site in 1988 when we first moved onto the land, and 20 years later there it is, nestling into the hillside. It's an earth sheltered house, passive solar design. I'm sure you all know what that means. The winter sun shines under the eaves to warm up the thermal mass inside the house and stored in the floor, and the summer sun, which is higher in the sky, is excluded so that the house stays cool in summer. We use local materials. We made the mud bricks ourselves, and the rocks were just from the quarry just over the hill. This is me planting the roof in, I think it was about 92. And that's the same roof 20 years later. We made the mud bricks ourselves with the help of friends. Very low tech. Dug a hole, shoveled in the clay, put in some straw, put in some water, got in and did a little dance with our feet, and then scooped out the clay. Very low tech, very cheap. And here's the mould. It's one of the moulds that we used. And then we planted grapevines over the northwestern areas where there were windows to create shade in the summer, and of course the grapevines lose their leaves in winter, allowing the sun to shine in. And the house garden was immediately in front of the house, just a few steps away. Compost toilets. The food comes off the land, so we believe the waste needs to go back onto the land, and the compost toilets produced an amazing amount of high quality worm compost that we use to fertilise our subtropical fruit trees. That's inside the compost toilet, the sitting one and the squatting one. And then after we'd been there a few years, people got interested in what we were doing, and we kept getting asked to run some educational programs. So we started to have school groups to visit, and we started to formally do education and courses. And we used to have university students come, and also we started to run PDCs. And we were very honoured when Robin came and talked part of a 1 week of a PDC on Rainbow Valley Farm. So because this is a short presentation, I'm going to leave Rainbow Valley Farm there. Rainbow Valley Farm is not open to the public anymore. It's now a private residence. However, if you want more information, there's lots of clips on YouTube. 5 minutes left? Okay, I'm going to speed up. So after Joe died in 2008, I kept the farm going for 3 years, and then it became a bit too much for me to manage, even with the help of friends and family. So I sold the farm and moved to the village. And this is my new project. I bought a quarter acre of bare land, and with, again, poor soils, heavy clay soils, compacted, ex-farmland, and you can see the kind of clay that I was dealing with. It's great for a potter, but a nightmare for a gardener. The first thing to do was to get in some water tanks. There's no water supply in the village, and we rely on catching rainwater from the roof and storing it in tanks. I had a wooden house built, a again, passive solar design, summer sun excluded, winter sun shining in, solar panels for hot water, photovoltaic cells for electricity, thermal mass in the form of a tile floor and this brick wall to absorb the sun's warmth, and also a wet back on my wood burner to heat the water in winter. And you can see how well that works here. This is in winter, the sun's shining in and warming up this brick wall. So then I started to create a garden from this. A bit of a challenge. I started with raised beds to get some vegetables going. That went very, very quickly. And creating fertility. So I used whatever I could get my hands on. Wood chips, compost, worms. I even started collecting my neighbour's unwanted grass clippings to make compost and to use as mulch. Building up the soil. Truckloads of mulch from friends who didn't need it. And then planting fruit trees in mounds, not planting them down in heavy clay, but on mounds. And also in wooden frames where the roots could get established before they had to go down into that clay. I planted herbal lay, lots of different orchard herbal lays with all kinds of beneficial plants to improve the soil, fix nitrogen, and generally improve the health of the soil. And within a very short space of time, my fruit trees were producing. I managed to squeeze in 50 different fruit trees on this quarter acre. Squeezed them in. And here you can see my bananas, apples, lots and lots of mulch on my food gardens, growing in mulch. And this is a picture of, this is a plum tree I'm planting here in 2012, and 3 years later it's producing massively. It goes remarkably fast. Feijoas do really, really well. Any of you from South America will know these in Australia extremely well. Bananas, persimmons, grapes, peaches, garlic, I'm spending out of time. Okay. And of course, I love my mushrooms, so I grow shiitake mushrooms on oak logs as well. And just some of my crops from this last summer, just gone. And I also got together with a friend and we established a community garden in our village down near the village hall. So this was a very exciting project and it works really well. And last slide, another initiative in our village. We have once a week a village green swap. For half an hour we come together, everyone brings the surplus from their gardens, we put it out on a table and we just swap. No money changes hands, but everybody goes home with something that they don't grow themselves. So that's it. Am I in time?
15 seconds to go.
Oh. Going to have time for questions at the end.
Yeah, that's what we decided, just to let everybody talk first and then we'd have some questions at the end. But I'm going to set up this video from Andrew Marr in Melbourne. So perhaps if anybody's got a burning question for Trish, she could answer one while I... John?
Yes. Yeah. I just want to know...
I'm going to remove the pictures,
yeah,
is that okay?
Yeah, yeah.
Yes.
I saw you and your husband in the garden. What are the children and what are the grandchildren in the process?
We didn't have any children. Yeah.
So your knowledge is...
We had a lot of adopted children. We had many, many thousands of whoopers and interns through Rainbow Valley Farm over 100 years. So I feel like I've got children and grandchildren in all different countries of the world. And for me, it's really fascinating and... It makes me very happy to see what those young people have gone on and done in their own countries, on their own projects. and I get Christmas cards and emails, and they keep in touch and they tell me what they're doing, and I feel so proud of what our adopted family are doing in all the countries of the world.
How did they arrive in the first place? How did they come to you?
How did they come to us? We had a website, and they used to contact us through the website,
right.
And we always had from between 2 and 8 woofers or interns. When interns came for a year or sometimes 2 years,
yeah.
But and the woofers came for maybe a month or 6 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. So
right.
They found us somehow.
Right. Mm-hmm. A lot of different ages.
Yeah.
Yeah.
All different ages. Our oldest one was 76 years old, and I think our youngest was about 16. So. Yes.
Sorry, technical one about the mushrooms.
Mushrooms.
We've tried a lot of different mushrooms and different types of wood, different types of mushrooms. None of them have grown. I know it's warmer where you are.
Yes.
But can you give us any essentials?
Essentials. A damp, shady place. They like damp and shady. And we tried many, many different woods. We tried all the native timbers. The best was oak. Oak and liquid amber. So,
oh,
Do you know which oak?
Not
oak.
Not she oak.
English oak.
And we had a deal with one of the local tree fellers who cut down trees. And after every storm, Joe would ring him up and say, "Are you cleaning up from anyone's fallen branches for oak logs?" And so then we'd get those and inoculate them with shiitake spores. We did other ones as well, Nameko, and but shiitake were the most successful. You want?
Okay. Okay, one more question. What sort of percentage of your food did you create?
We had about 85% of our food came off our farm. We couldn't grow grains, it's too humid in our region, so we had to buy wheat and other grains. And just tell me when to stop.
Please carry on, we've got a technical problem.
Okay.
Trish, I noted that you were growing mushrooms on banana leaves.
Banana leaves, yes.
Yeah,
oyster
mushrooms.
We put the banana leaves in cardboard boxes.
Yeah.
And
dried ones or fresh
ones?
Okay.
Yeah. And stuffed them full, quite full, and made the box damp.
Yeah.
And then inoculate, put the spores inside.
Fantastic.
Yeah, it worked really well.
Because we're doing stuff with coffee grounds and sawdust at the moment, but
yes.
I really...
We did try it on straw, but we found we had to sterilise the straw first because it had lots of other fungi in it.
Yeah.
So the banana leaves worked really well.
Okay, great.
And you chopped the bananas?
Chopped them up and stuffed them in, yeah.
Okay, I really apologise, but plenty of time to ask Trish more questions. We've got a bit of a problem here. We've got different connectors between these two laptops. So we've got a film here, and it might be worth watching it. It's a small screen, but it might be worth watching it. I mean, would you like to have a go at watching it, and or we can skip and we can go to Anne-Marie?
It's a good
go.
Should
we have a go?
See how it comes up. Yeah.
How
long is the film?
15 minutes.
In a small screen.
On a small screen.
Can we have a
next
presentation until we find a solution for this?
Yeah, because this is actually only on this.
Apparently,
they can't transfer it from any other.
No.
It only arrived yesterday.
Give it a go.
Do you want to put the chair on the table?
I have a chair.
Good idea.
Do you need this kind of connector?
Oh, you're a star. Yes.
I borrowed that from Albert Biggs in Cuba, and I've been carrying it ever since.
Very lucky. Can you come down?
Is it that one?
Turn on the light.
They've even gone to the next level from that as well. So
is the connection on this computer?
Could
you turn on your light for that?
I think it's the next one on from that, even.
And there's nothing on this side?
No. USB, both USBs.
Alright,
well, let's give it a go.
So close.
We've got sound. Sound.
Seed pays the farmers 50 cents for every tree that they keep alive every year. And farmers are able to plant up to 500 trees, thereby generating an income of around $250, which in many cases more than doubles their annual income. The reforestation program, as farmers see it, is vital to their future. years ago, these mountains and these hillsides here would have been covered with forest. And today, as you can see, maybe a sense of a lot of green, but certainly not a sense of forest by any means. So the planting method that we've got with the farmers.
Ego is from Timor Leste and he's going to present last. Do you want to talk a little bit about Timor Leste?
Planting the mahogany trees every 3 to 4 meters apart, but not clearing the land like you would imagine a plantation to be, but allowing the saplings to grow and form a natural forest. With One Seed manages this program through a community tree cooperative model where farmers come together and work together in community-based nurseries to propagate the trees and then work together to plant them. The trees are planted on individual farmers' land and the farmers own those trees. So in 20-25 years' time, they'll have timber that they'll be able to use to build houses or potentially trade with. The idea of planting the mahogany trees is to stabilise the soil, remove the degradation and erosion, improve the soil, improve crop yields, and return the native habitat. The second commitment is about economic participation. A large percentage of the population of Timor Leste, particularly those subsistence farming communities in the district, are living on less than 80 cents a day. And through with One Seed, we want to put a dollar in their pockets so that they can make a choice on how they live. This provides them with the opportunity to be able to make choices. It's about paying for school fees, about buying better seeds and getting better crop yields.
Sorry about this, guys.
And generally about raising the standard of living. With One Seed is keen to see these communities move beyond charity and aid in the social enterprise models that are being developed. They're going to empower these communities to be able to take control of their lives together.
Talk about how this links to your initiative as well on the with the educational materials with Permatil. You link with Andrew Mahar on your resources.
Yeah, this project just started, so they're working in the eastern part of Timor, so they're working in one of the sub districts. So that's the main focus.
Mm-hmm.
So now we're working on producing the permaculture manual.
Yeah.
So that's how we come together to collaborate.
Mm-hmm. and he's going to be distributing the permaculture manual for tropical
yeah.
for a tropical ecosystems,
yeah.
isn't he? Yeah.
Who funds that? The public the creation of the publication.
This one?
Yeah, I've met no,
no,
making
no,
printing
the talk
and making manual.
The crowdfunding for it's got another week.
Yeah.
So
ah,
it'd be
right.
great to contribute.
Yeah.
yeah. Okay, that's Andrew. His connection is more successful than his film in terms of the.
Quick 1C, we're building a local economy to move beyond subsistence living. As citizens of the region, we have a responsibility to ensure that all our children have food on the table, have a decent education, and have a secure and safe house to live in. Only through true economic participation and the development of local economies can this become a reality. With One Seed's third commitment is about open education. Ensure that all children are able to complete a primary education. We're developing curriculum material to meet the Australian National Curriculum. The program is called With One Planet and focuses on three key areas: carbon, culture, and citizenship. Skills development opportunities by using.
Thank you.
try switching off.
Try switching off HD in the right corner. Yeah.
Speed normal quality.
Yeah, just something more. Should be better now.
How is the way?
Although you are buried when the caves collapse under.
Well,
a heavy air bombardment that people are buried alive there. With 1C is working to build relationships across the Asia Pacific region. Between school children, between teachers, between business, to try and ensure that we all understand our responsibilities in this global age. It's pretty obvious our environs and lifestyles are starkly different than those of our near neighbours in Timor. However, the atmosphere knows no boundaries. Our pollution, our carbon, travels the globe, and we all have a responsibility to do something about it. You are able to participate in helping us plant forests in Timor simply by offsetting the technology you use.
This is a seed. It might not look like much now, but with a little bit of help and some time, this seed will grow into something very special. Every single day, over 2 billion videos, just like this one, are viewed on YouTube. These videos are stored in data farms, which produce over 4,000 tons of carbon. When we factor in all of the emails we send, the data we share, and the music we listen to, the total emissions generated are on par with the aviation industry. So why is this little seed so important? Well, as seeds grow into trees, they absorb carbon from the atmosphere. So the more seeds that we plant, the better off our world will be. With One Seed is working with farmers in East Timor to plant trees and build communities. So far, over 40,000 trees have been planted across 10 villages, but you can help take this further. For as little as $5, you can offset your computer or smartphone for a whole year. This money will help farmers in East Timor to buy more seeds and plant more trees, growing their communities, building their economies, and replenishing our environment. With this seed, we're planting an idea. We want everyone to become more aware of the environment we live in. Plant a seed now by downloading our My Carbon Capture app or by visiting the With One Seed website. Change can grow with one seed.
Strong community-led regional partnerships will create learning opportunities to raise awareness. Less than an hour offshore of northern Australia, there are people who are living on less than 80 cents a day. And that there are simple steps that we can take as global citizens to ensure that we live in a fair and equitable region.
Finally, and I believe it will be successful, then it can inspire and replicate elsewhere around the country.
We live in one world, in one environment, and we all have responsibility to look after it. Through regional partnerships, we can change the world one seed at a time.
Skype at the moment. He's wondering if he can come and hear the other presenter sessions, but I don't think our tech is going to be strong enough to cope with that. Certainly my brain isn't strong enough to cope with that right now.
Should you want to be there to answer questions? Is that what you're saying?
No, I mean, I've let him know that we're going to do it all at the end, because Ego's needs, his team needs to come in as well. So we're going to switch. Next up, we have Anne-Marie Brookman, and Anne-Marie is in southern Australia, running a family farm, a commercial organic farm,
yep.
And it's also PDC, or actually a permaculture diploma,
yep.
A diploma trainer as well, aren't you? So, we don't need sound for yours, do we?
No.
Great.
get you on then.
Okay.
Where is my whole screen?
So I'm obviously going to talk about our lessons learned at the food forest from living on the edge. We arrived on the edge of Adelaide, and Adelaide was growing. And so the observations from the last 30 years, essentially. This is what my presentation consists of, a bit of an overview. Where are we in Australia? Our climatic conditions, which are very different to Trish and Ego and Europe. Who we are and what we do. The lessons we've learned from 30 years of farming, and then throw in this climate change, and how do we live with that, and where do we go on from there? So just to put you in the picture, Australia is more than twice the size of Europe as we see it here. Ego and Andrew are up here, and Trish's New Zealand is down there. So it's absolutely huge. And Robin Francis lives up there, about 2,000 kilometres from where I live. Lockie McKenzie, who will help Ego a bit later with his presentation, 3,000 kilometres. David Holmgren spoke 700 kilometres away from us. And Bill Mollison lives 1,200 kilometres away from us. To give you perspective on the climatic conditions, there's absolutely desert in the centre. Robin copes with about 2 metres of rainfall where she is. Darwin's probably higher. Cool temperate in Tassie, and we are hot, dry Mediterranean. So that gives you a bit of an idea of where we sit. Our temperatures in the summer range from about 23, which is a nice cool day, to 42, and we've actually experienced 47.2 a couple of years ago, and that's not the only time. Our winters are very mild. This weather we're having here is kind of our winter weather. Our annual rainfall is 400 millimetres, not centimetres, so it's about that much. And that is when we have a normal year, and we haven't had a normal year for quite a number of years. And our annual evaporation, and that's where makes South Australian farming such a challenge, is more than I'm tall. So if you have water stored in an open container, like a dam or a swimming pool, you lose more than four times the amount in evaporation than what you get in rainfall. So water is seriously our greatest challenge. South Australia can boast the driest state in the driest inhabited continent, and we have an evaporation rate that is absolutely massive. So who are we, what do we do? We're 20 hectares on the Adelaide Plains, which is just north of Adelaide. We grow about 150 food varieties. A lot come from the same latitude as Adelaide is on. A little bit of native food, so it's a productive place. We apply deficit irrigation, which means we apply very strategically around flowering and just prior to full fruit or nut set in the case of fruit trees. We value add on our property. We have invested heavily in some small scale machinery, which you'll see later. We compost the waste on our farm so that the cycle is closed as much as we can. We have woofers on our farm, and we do traineeships or internships as well. Woofing stands for willing workers on organic farms. And we have really limited that to two, absolute maximum of three people per time. And that is to enhance the interaction and the relationships and the educational exchange. We also teach. We've taught more than 400 people in PDCs and many, many more on one-day workshops. We are very much into passive solar design and energy efficient buildings, and we employ five staff, some are far time. So this is us. You'll see Graham roaming around, slightly balder and a little bit more grey, which applies to me as well, roaming around at the conference as well. And we have two children, Tom and Nikki, and Tom's close to 30 and Nikki is 26, and she's roaming around Europe as we speak. So we very early on decided we needed a very, very clear mission statement, both for ourselves and for the people who would come on our place to understand what we do, and I guess give us that focus and rein us in. So it was to demonstrate that land can be used in a sustainable way, but not just that we could also have a sustainable life financially as a business, that we are very keen to share information with people and to inspire and empower other people, and that at the same time our farm is also our home and a place where our kids grow up, and so it had to be a beautiful place to live in harmony and be productive, and I think we've produced a couple of very nice kids. So where did we start? We started with a permaculture design course taught by Bill Mollison in Adelaide in 1983. And despite the fact that both Graham and I have agricultural science background, I come from Holland, went to uni there, Graham from Adelaide, despite our knowledge, we didn't have a clear kind of design skill set to put 15 hectares of land, which you can see is just wheat farming, and that was our combi, together. So that PDC was very crucial to us and set the pace. So we have nice deep alluvial soil, we're right next to a river, which you'll see later, and we have a very shallow aquifer, which is no longer at 30 metres, but more at 60 metres, because water is that big resource that is so scarce now. And we had one tree on the place. So if you then fast track it to some 20 years later, that's where old Combi would have been had he still had it. It's just essentially a lifetime of both of us working quite hard. And we designed it in 83 after the PDC and very much stuck to it. The only thing we overlooked was our evaporation rate. Every permaculture farm needs to have a dam, not in South Australia. That's the one thing we would not do again, is build a dam. And that's observation and taking stock and all the rest of it. But now, this is 400 metres from our boundary. And so that's the urban sprawl. Very badly designed, not the land lease that Jonathan Porritt was talking about. You can see it focuses on roads, not a hell of a lot on food. But there are roofs and there is rainfall. So whilst it is so close to us, we can harvest that rainfall because this just runs off into our river. It's not harvested. So problems turn into solutions. So having urban areas so close to our farm, there are so many ill-conceived ideas in the community about farms, what they are. They're smelly, they spray all sorts of horrible stuff, and people have fear about what farmers do. So us, as farmers, have a great responsibility to educate the community, to improve their knowledge, to get rid of their preconceived ideas, and to basically explain that we can be very, very good neighbours. Urbanites also need to have really access to very, very good food. So what that means in terms of keeping land available for farming is a really important thing. So what we've actually done on our farm is we've applied for a re-evaluation of the land value, which means that our rates and taxes are appropriate for rural land and not for land that is potentially available for urban development, which our land isn't, because we're right on a flat plain and they can't. So that means that our rates and taxes are a lot lower and appropriate to farming rather than potential urban development. And there's some other ways that this can happen. The other good thing that urban areas offer is, of course, a lot of nutrient cycling, and Trish talked about that in her presentation about what other people don't want, and also water from roofs that they don't harvest. So all is not bad. So another aerial shot of our farm, and it's just here now, this was taken 5 years ago, now all of this here has that rooftop development there. So we're close. And our river, which interestingly is dry 9 months of the year, being South Australia, runs on our northern boundary. So we grow lots of crops. Here are just some examples of them. And because of our wonderful climate, we can grow food all year round. And we have colder, cooler vegetables that are happier in the winter. And we have the heat lovers. We also can grow a wonderful assortment of Mediterranean types of fruit. So we are very lucky in that respect. We grow a little bit of timber, both for structural timber for building, but also for our own firewood store. We don't need a hell of a lot of it, but we're self-reliant in that little forest that we've planted. And we integrate poultry in our farm very much as the weeders and the graders of pest management and weed management. Obviously they need fences to contain them, and we eat our animals. So it's a very sort of close cycle. We've also included 2 sheep to manage the things that the geese don't like eating. Our northern boundary is the river, and we have done an enormous amount of work in terms of improving the habitat. It had been taken over by a lot of European weeds, and the native vegetation had actually, essentially apart from big red gums, wasn't there. This has also meant that our local community, urban areas that are sprawling out towards us, can become involved in nature and their local environment, so that awareness raising that's not just focused on the food forest, but on communal land. This land on our northern boundaries is owned by the council. But we just decided early on that we needed to specialise in something to make us strong, to give us a niche and to be able to take control plate to plate, and something that was different to what was commonly grown in our area. And after a lot of research, we got to pistachios. So it's a beautiful tree. We do paddock to plate, so we harvest by hand, which offers local employment. We have invested in some very specialised, small-scale, appropriate machinery that complies with the organic certification standards and is small and we can manage ourselves, and also is available for other people to use. And that same dehydrator for pistachios, you'll see later on, we can use for other things as well. And just like early on, we went to a lot of field days and became members of organisations to glean information. We now actually extend out to the permaculture, the pistachio growers community in South Australia, who think we're all nuts. Why would we, pardon the pun, why would we have a lower yield and not, be able to spray what they want to spray with? But our price per kilo is much higher, and we have total paddock to plate control over the. This is a Sicilian machinery that can crack the pistachio machines that don't, the pistachios that don't split. So again, yields a high value crop. We market most of our stuff at the farmers market, which is 50 kilometres from us in Adelaide in the city centre, which is next to the showgrounds and has about between 5,000 and 6,000 people coming through on a Sunday. We attend once a fortnight, so that on the weekends in between we can run courses and stay in bed till later than 4:30 in the morning. Our machinery can also dry other food crops, so we value add, we minimise waste, we have higher value crops and so on. We make wine. And we also eat really, really well ourselves, and not only us, but during our PVCs and any catering that we may do. Hey, Robin, I've just remembered, in my bag, the yellow one at the bottom, is a plastic bag full of pistachios, which I brought for you guys to eat. And I completely forgot about. So the only thing you're not allowed to do is throw the shells on the floor. So it's a big plastic bag, and just somehow spread it around. Share it, eat it. Certified organic from South Australia. There you go. So essentially, when we run our permaculture design courses, we also 5 minutes. Eight minutes. Thank you. We also produce our own food. So we export. We harvest. So we definitely need to look after the quality of our soil. Standard in Australian farming soils sit on 1 to 2% carbon. We, in our vegetable garden, manage just to analyse it 8.2 by an independent lab. We make compost from our farm waste. We also buy in compost made from urban waste. These guys organise sort of to organic standards as well as Australian compost making standards. And we so that's the bigger cycle, waste from Adelaide. We build with straw to be energy efficient, but not only that. It's just a material that we have locally available. We're very keen that young people can build things, so we also look at small, do-it-yourself, but at the same time meet the regulations. We are very keen. We've got a hot, dry summer, so we use the sun, and we have both photovoltaics and have the sun for heating our rainwater. And I haven't particularly got slides of it, but our house is heritage listed. It's old by South Australian standards, 170 years. And so we've got the old with the new, and the new buildings are definitely passive solar designs. Being a dry state, we really need to look at water catchment and how we harvest it, so we have lots of rainwater tanks. We also recycle all our wastewater, mimicking natural systems, both on farm and at our house. And it's again all approved by our health department, which we feel is very important to empower other people. Irrigation is all by drip irrigation direct onto the soil, and we mulch a lot, so we cover the soil in summer, and there is at least 40, sometimes 50 degrees Celsius degree temperature difference between being mulched and not mulched. Then education, we teach a lot ourselves. We also bring other people in. So David Holmgren teaches in our permaculture design course. Robin Playfield, who's also at this conference, teaches in facilitation and education. We run school groups, uni groups, and so on. And you know, it's the experience. One of these kids said, "Anna Marie, it's freezing under the mulch," but actually, it was a 40 degree difference. So to understand is by experience. We extend into our further local communities. We have a lot of refugees, and so this particular site was taken to teach people from Burundi to, you know, what does it mean to farm in South Australia, which is a very different climate to Burundi. We communicate with politicians. The guy on the right is South Australia's premier. And so it's really important to communicate your idea, to communicate the design and the understanding. We've also found that it was very important to test our systems against mainstream food producers. So we've won a few awards, and people sort of think, oh, permaculture, well, it was dreadlocks and, you know, barefoot. So if we now look at, you know, this is what we've created, and add the extra change and challenge of global warming, which for us will mean hotter summers, less rain, all of those sorts of things, then how do we go about that? So we've got a few records under our belt. We got to 47.2 degrees, 5 minutes. And so, and you know, there's not just been 1 or 2 days, so there've been whole stretches of it, and where the nights don't go below 29 degrees, and then you don't actively cool your house, that becomes quite hot. And we don't have an air conditioner, by the way, which is unusual for South Australia. So we've got all these records. Now, this last summer, we had a bushfire quite close to us. As the crow flies, that's probably 3 kilometres. And in the first 30 hours, that nearly burnt 12,000 hectares. And had the wind changed, that could have easily engulfed those urban rooftops that you saw, and us. Luckily, it didn't. So how do we equip ourselves and our local community with that? Last April, when David Holmgren taught in our permaculture design course, we actually did a community event as well, where he spoke to our local community, together with our country fire service, CFS, about how to make our local community more resilient to, you know, extremes like fire. And we've, at the food forest now, run a number of workshops. One was called Fiery Women. What often happens is that in rural areas, the guys will go out and fight the fire, and the women are left behind, you know, on the farm. I know that's very stereotypical, but that is what often happens. And a lot of women have never actually, now closer to urban areas, pulled a pump or, you know, ran a truck or anything like that. So that was that local resilience. We are installing more rainwater tanks. That's 22,000 litres going in. It was a challenge. We got there. It collects water. But a bigger thing is that with climate change, our winters are getting warmer. And you'd say, oh, that's lovely. But what that actually means in terms of fruit set of a whole lot of trees, like apples and cherries and pistachios, is that because the winters are warmer, it disrupts the coordination of male and female flowers, and flowering fruit stops. So here is a slide that's in February, where you should have full pistachio nuts, but at the same time, there are still flowers happening. So the yields drop dramatically because fertilisation doesn't take place. So what do you do? It takes 7 years for a pistachio tree to start, 7 years before it starts cropping, so you can't just knock it down and start again. We are now looking at varieties that have low chill requirement, and they do exist, and we graft them on, and we take it from there. So that's something we're looking at. And at the same time, we're lucky that we've got the machinery, because a lot of low chill varieties of pistachios don't split naturally on the tree, so we can then crack them to the kernel. So to finish up with, I guess the lessons that we've learned is that it is really, really important to integrate our local environment, the urbanites, and everybody into awareness raising, and we do that through education and experiencing, you know, beautiful food, really interesting places, nice people, And I guess our greatest mission still remains the whole education and the integration of permaculture and sustainable farms into our local community. And if everybody grows a little bit of food, whether it's in a tub, on a rooftop, on a balcony, it is just an amazing start. Thank you. And if you want to see more, tomorrow afternoon our DVD, Design for Life, will show, and it's also for sale during the conference. So, thank you.
Thank you, Anne-Marie. Next up we've got Ego Lemos. He's he's an activist, a singer, a performer from East Timor, and he's the founder of Permatil, which I gather is a pre-independence organic movement, emerged from a pre-independence organic movement. So, looking forward to this one.
Thank you. Good morning, everyone. So I'm going to be presenting with Lachlan McKenzie. He's one of our partners. So, yeah, we start the permaculture. How about this?
Maybe it's the other one. Yeah. Try that one. Yeah, that one. The rest, the right one. No?
No. The history of permaculture in Timor Leste is actually Timor Leste is used to be colony by Portuguese for 450 years, and then used to be a big island. But when the Portuguese and the Dutch arrived back in 1500. So Dutch and Portuguese, they divided the island into two. So half island is now is still part of Indonesia, and the half island is independent. But then after Portuguese left in 1975, but then the Indonesia invaded Timor, and then so occupied for 24 years. So we've been struggled through armed resistance, clandestine and everything, to try to liberate the country. So we actually independence in 2002, but the Indonesia left late in 1999 through the referendum. So majority of the population they choose for independence. So back in 1963, during the Portuguese time, Timor-Leste is already achieved the food sufficient. So all across the whole country is every household, they have enough food, they have animals, and they have, they grow different types of vegetable, fruits, and so on. So it's already achieved food sufficient in 1963. But then because of the the Green Revolution started back in 1960, so Portuguese government also get influenced, trying to change the country that they colony to into a monoculture system. So that they starting to introduce a new variety of rice into Timor, start 1960s, to unify the agriculture in Timor. So start from that, then slowly agriculture system in Timor start to change. So from traditional agriculture into starting to modern agriculture. So Portuguese starting to introduce like a plantation, coffee plantation, and then vanilla plantation. And so they starting to clear up the old forest, and then they planting with coffee. So therefore, sometime you know, you find Timorese coffee is been selling around the world because of the Portuguese introduced the coffee in Timor. So then it's starting to, from the polyculture, also the Timorese farmers, they have traditional knowledge on conserving land, seeds, and also water, and also forest. So later, it's starting to decline because of the Portuguese introducing like a Christianity, which is don't believe on the spirit of the land, but because that it's empty. So therefore, it's influencing the people to not respecting, not value their traditional knowledge, and then so Timorese farmers starting to adopting the new idea of farming. So that's before that, so we actually so during Indonesian time, like 1996-97, so I'm part of the student movement that time. So because of we observed that the farmers become more dependent and dependent to the external input. When the economic crisis hit Indonesia or Asia in 1997, so all the prices of the chemical fertilizer, pesticide, seeds is gone up 200%. So most of our farmers starting to sit back and don't want to grow anything, rice or vegetable, because they rely on fertilizer. So then we starting to part of the student movement. So we. I, with my friend, we start a small organized movement called Organic Agriculture Movement back in 1997. So because of the, you know, Indonesian army or the government, they won't let any Timorese to gather. If you gather more than one people, they will arrest you, or you will be disappeared. So because of the political pressure, so I have to. Working with the human rights organization and women organization back in 1997, and as well as the part of the university student. So we keep influencing our people that we have to continue this, because otherwise, when we independence, we lost all of our knowledge. So after Indonesia left in 99, so then I've met a permaculture friend from Australia. So I think Lachlan can tell you more about that.
Yeah, well, I actually met Steve Fran at a course with Robin Francis Fran, about learning how to do permaculture and how to work in indigenous communities, developing countries. And I followed Steve over in 2001. By that time, he'd already met Ego and already started teaching courses, and it seemed like, you know, it was just one of those meetings where Steve grabbed Ego and said, I want you to be my translator, and Steve kind of talks in such a way that it's hard for anyone really to understand his colloquialisms and sayings, but Ego worked it out somehow, and they started the permaculture movement, and sometimes takes very strong people to go in and start things like that. And then from there, Ego and a few other mates with Steve kind of developed it. And then when I went over there, I think the third day we got lost up in the mountains, and Ego said, "Oh, I'm not sure where we are, but I think I know where we need to go." And we went up and found this amazing kind of Homolulic traditional home up in the mountains, and that was my introduction to Timor after 3 days. And it just kind of developed from there, and then slowly but surely Permaculture and the Timorese have created their own NGO and their own version of permaculture, and have made all the decisions themselves. That's the most important thing. There's been many Australians and permaculturists from other countries go over and have helped out a lot, but we've been the ones, I suppose, advising and kind of helping out, whereas the main drivers have been Ego and Atai and Adminia and the Timorese people who have become more than permaculture experts in their own rights. So.
Yeah, since that time, it's the right time that the permaculture being introduced in Timor, because is since late 99, so all the United Nations all may arrive in East Timor, and everybody have a different agenda to introduce develop agriculture in Timor. So they're all, you know, influenced by the World Bank and IMF is trying to implementing industrial agriculture in the small country like Timor. So they are starting to introduce tractors, fertilizer, seeds, and so on from overseas to Timor. And in this that time, even us and with all most of the farmers, we almost like feeling marginalized in our country. We sitting back and just watching, because this all of the ideas is very new to us. So then when I've met Steve Crane that time, and he explained to me about permaculture, and I completely know nothing about permaculture, and I thought this permaculture is a kind of animal. So, so then he took me to one village. It's in the eastern part of Dili. It's the capital city of Timor, and to show me about some example. He shows me a few books of permaculture books, including Bill Morrison books, and he showed me some practical thing. And then at that time, honestly, I didn't speak any very tiny English. I only read his mind. So that's what, and he asked me to be his translator. So he explained to the farmers about the ideas of permaculture. So I just read his mind and then tried to translate. And then we ran the first course, permaculture policy course in 2000. So anyway, it's a long story. Then in actually, because of the Steve, we start an institute called East Timor Permaculture Development Institute. And so we run courses, three courses per PDC per year. So after 2002, so I got a permaculture diploma from Permaculture Institute in Australia, signed by Bill Mollison. So then Steve says to me, "So now you can start your own, because I have to go back to Australia." So Steve left, so then just by myself. So then I initiating, go around and look for some friend, so we start Permaculture Timor Leste. So we don't call institute, because we can't manage that. So that's we just start a very small organization with few people. So we call Permaculture Timor Leste, and finally we found some organization want to support. Is one is a concern international NGOs that we working in one of the sub district in a region called Turiscai. So that's and so we done many project that time. So since Steve left, we don't do PDC, because Then I see 2 weeks PDC. It's like putting so much information to the people's brain, and they don't know how to read and write. And then it's hard for them to pick up all the information in 2 weeks. So then we changed our methodology. So we just teach based on the need of the community. If they need water, and we go and do an assessment, and then teach them how to store their spring water, and then vegetate their area so that they could have good soil, good water, so that they could continue with their production, and so on. So, and so many ideas. So again, we're teaching based on the need of the farmers.
So, yeah, we can probably move on
yeah.
to the next one. You'll see examples through the next slides and of all this stuff, but the main thing to show about the training was that the two-week courses weren't practical, but Permaculture was still teaching permaculture. It was just divided up into little pieces, and the farmers and the communities, and especially women who couldn't do the two-week courses because they've got too many obligations, could then join in with these courses of 3 or 4 days, then they could do it for a few months, then the next course, and then more monitoring and practice, and it was a much more sustainable way, and it would actually ingrain all this knowledge in the community and for everyone. So, and Permatil is one of the leaders in Timor in terms of not just having women come along to train, but actually having women trainers, and that actually makes a massive difference in a country, I'd say quite patriarchal in its kind of systems. And to actually have women being able to train women, especially, and also to show that women can, especially in the field of agriculture, it's, you know, in a traditional country like that, it's, so you can see some of the ideas, like so much training's gone over the years. I'm amazed, like every time I kind of like, so who's off where? And someone, one of them's in one district and two of them are off in another district, and then Ego's off somewhere else, and like, you know, government, all the NGOs, local community groups. But that last point there, the model for training permaculture in developing countries, I think there's a few other countries doing this style of shorter courses over a longer period, but it's proven really successful.
Yeah, so since that we keep proving to our government that small scale is work better than the bigger scale. So our government is investing billions of dollars into agriculture development in Timor with different international agencies, and for more than 13 years, and now they found it's all failed. So, and we're keeping the small scale and try to influence the policy making of agriculture. So this, again, as Lockman has mentioned, that we emphasize to promote women as a trainer. So the women teach the farmers how to make the clay stove and so on. And there's also a few projects that we're doing in different places around the country. So that's, you see the pictures, a nursery that we designed using spiral design so that we could also for the nursery, and also for the meeting, also we built the garden run, so as a model for the community to see. And that's also as a educational material and also demonstration site. So, Lachlan?
One of the things I was asked to do was to write a backup, which we thought would be a 50 or 80 page book. And after 3.5 years, something a lot bigger. So Ego and I wrote this together with Permatil and lots of other amazing help over there, and we're actually upgrading it at the moment for all tropical countries. So it's been a big process, but it's amazing to see how that knowledge helps to back up, and we wrote it for the people specifically. That's so important. Like, it's got over 2,000 amazing illustrations. So doing, so the people who can't read and write can still get so much out of it. And that was the focus from the very beginning. This is the first two chapters of the new edition. So So come and have a look later, and you can see the new technique, new layout and stuff. But what we want to do is, we've seen that this has worked in Timor, so we want to make it, it'll be online for free for people to be able to use. That's what we need. We need this information to get out there. Very practical knowledge. But based on the results of what we saw was needed, that the people could actually use and how they could actually take on that information.
Would you mind passing those around?
Yes, certainly.
So because of the time, so I keep scrolling the slide, and you can see here is a compost toilet that's rebuilt out of local material, and then as well as we grow different banana pits and vine on top. And so that's using the drop irrigation with bamboo, and also the garden, the home garden around the house, and also office. And so this is the platform for community advocacy and change. So since 2002, so Permaculture is initiating to establish a national and sustainable agricultural network around the country, called Hasatil, is involving the whole farmers group. And also, I'm teaching at the National University, introducing permaculture into a national university curriculum. And also, we established Permaculture Scout, or Permaculture Youth Movement in Timor, which is now we have the, we run national camp every 2 years. So we built up, start from 2008. We have 400 young people gathering. And then 2009, we have 600 young people gathering. 2012, we have 800 young people gathering for 5 days. And this November, we'll have 1,000 young people gathering for 1 week. So that's what we do. And then we also link in with the farmers movement around the world called La Via Campesina. And also we had an expo. We also doing some media with radio and film, and also music. So also, yeah, we're doing writing music about the environment, about farmers and so on, trying to influence the people in different ways. And we also introducing traditional dancing and so on. So,
so just to kind of tie back in to this discussion about small scale farming, and to be honest, like most of Timor is small landholder farms. The government are trying to do bigger stuff, but generally that hasn't worked that well. And to strengthen in the community, we want to preserve that small landholder style. And from some of the feedback that's come over the years is that the farmers are really happy because, and the communities, because they get to choose. Permaculture helps them to facilitate good choices, but the communities are the ones who make the choice of what they need. And then the second point is that they understand that they see the bigger picture thing. Like, people intrinsically know when they're given just a small focus point that maybe that doesn't actually help overall, or maybe it's just like, you know, one part that they need to see that the bigger picture and the overall design and concept of the bigger picture that permaculture and permaculture has provided, people have seen that gives them more security.
So we go to the community, we're not just teaching, but we encourage them. So we just more facilitate them to bring all their traditional knowledge, their all local knowledge, to put together, to you know, to bring all their potential knowledge together to solve their problem. So when we're living, they don't depend on us. So we want to create self-dependence and problem solving by the community themselves. So again, you can see this some of the example and the feature. So just this permaculture 2013, I've been involved part of the national curriculum team working for Ministry of Education to reform national curriculum for Timor Leste government. So we succeed to include permaculture into the national curriculum, which is will be implemented in 1,415 schools across the country. So, and this is the book that we are going to publish end of September for Permaculture Garden for the Kids. So the kids will have the book so that they could take home to share with their parents as well as at the school. So I just, before I came, I just finished the manual for the teacher to part of the national curriculum.
I saw it yesterday. It's amazing. If you get a chance, get Ego to show you.
I haven't had a hard copy with me.
So the same artist that helped with the big guidebook, and yeah, it's really...
It's a colorful picture, so that to attract kids to love the book. And next year, we're going to start first Perma Kids Camp. So start from 10 years to the 15. So, and also we try to establish the demo site. We're going to choose a few schools to start off. So we start three schools this year, and hopefully by next year we're going to expand and teaching the teacher in few schools to start the as a demo site. And also, yeah, again, teaching the field work for the teacher. And also again, in Timor, we have school lands. So hopefully from the school garden can provide good school lands for the children. Because at the moment, school lunch is provided by the government, and the rice and the beans and everything is imported. So we want the kids to eat local variety that they grow themselves. And this, again, for the generation change. So I think the last is important for us is the permaculture is not only with us, but we have to pass the knowledge to our next generation. We want them to smile like what we did now. We don't want them to sad in the future. So this is the future one. One again is about food sovereignty. So we want the farmers, every farmers to own their own seed and they control the seed from the seed to the plate.
I suppose from my perspective, just very quickly, I've been amazed at the amount of dedication to the concept of food sovereignty that Permaculture has carried through their work. And that's really important when you're coming up against all these different influences which are trying to say other things. And to make sure that that security is there, that not just the knowledge, but the practical ability to control your own food destinies. And then there's a few little examples there in the pictures, but I think food sovereignty movement is getting a lot stronger, and I think I've been learned a huge amount from my time in Timor about that.
So I hope you all enjoy Permaculture Conference, Convergence, and we're here to share, to complement each other. When we go home, we could bring new inspiration to empower our people to make a change for the world. Thank you.
Thanks to everybody who's just presented. I think it's really interesting to see how these knit together, and most of these projects have gone well beyond biodiversity conservation. We're now looking at extreme ecosystem restoration in some places. And interesting to see the different entry points that the different projects have used to create viable livelihoods, whether it's village level sharing and production to organic farm level, to what's actually happening with trees and the carbon credits in East Timor as well. So I'm wondering if we've got 25 minutes for questions for the panel. I'm wondering whether everybody can come up.
Yeah.
Do you want to sit there?
Yeah. Thank you.